Happy Sunday morning, everyone. Welcome to the weekend edition. We are joined by many, many people, many, many beautiful people, including yourselves. But to my left here, Zama Memela is back.
Hello.
Chef extraordinaire. Yeah? Did you enjoy the last time you were here? You did
That's
one episode.
That's why I'm back.
That's why you're back. What are we going to be doing today?
We are going to be doing something very exciting that we're celebrating throughout this whole year.
Okay.
But I'm going to let you sample something and tell me what it's all about.
Wow. Oh, so it's a secret. What, is this like a puzzle? We have to figure out what today's food theme is today. Okay, fine. All right. Our musical guest today, Mr. Brian Temba. How are you, man?
Man, I'm good.
Welcome
to
the weekend edition.
Thank you for having me.
Is that an Illuminati pin? What is that symbol there on the lapel?
This like, is...
Have you joined the illuminated ones?
No, I ain't going there. Why? Yeah. Why is that?
It's very cryptic. He doesn't want to tell us what it is.
It's Bogart. It's Bogart. It's a clothing line. It's a,
shop. Is it a label?
Man's clothing shop. It's called Bogart, yes. Yeah.
No, man. Well, thank you for coming to join us this week.
Thank
you're going
you
to bless
having
us
me,
with
man.
Some new music?
Yes, yeah? Definitely, yeah.
All right, man. Yeah. And what's happening in the dining room?
So much is happening at the dining room. I'm chilling with a beautiful woman who's acted in many roles, but the best role was that her being Mandela's mother.
The best role is the one that we're going to do together.
Movie.
It's our story.
Movie.
It hasn't happened.
Produces.
Yes.
But you're here to share with us your weekend experiences, things that you do over the weekend.
Yes.
Do
very
actresses
much so.
Get off and do things over the weekend?
Yes. You know how it is. I mean, we work, what, a 12-hour day minimum?
24-hour sometimes.
Exactly. Yes. So you got to find that little thing to do in between, the stuff that gets your energy going, yeah. You keeps you inspired, maybe a little bit fit.
Yes, a little bit body.
A little bit body,
yes.
A little bit happy, a little bit excitement, so yeah.
A little bit of things. Well, stick around because I'd love you to hang out with us.
Yeah.
Before we go anywhere, I'd like to start your Sunday morning with a great song from Brian Temba. Here we go.
Domino's.
When I wrote the song, Lost Without You, I was sitting next to a very special person in my life, and I wondered what I would do without them. I'd be lost without them. How could I live without you? What would I do if you left me? Can't even think of a second that you're not here. What we have is sent from above. It's not natural that you're not here. It feels so cold in my bed, 'cause you're not here now.
When I said I loved you,
baby, I did.
Will you please come back,
come back to me? Without you, wherever you are, I hope you hear me. Baby, I'm lost without you.
Oh.
I give anything ever since the day that you left me. All of my days have been empty. I've cried and cried to move on, but you're engraved in me. Our favorite song plays on the radio, and I think of you, baby, but you're not here now.
When I said I loved you,
I just wanna be with you. Can't you hear me crying now? Baby, you're a part of me.
Said I'm lost without you. Oh, baby, I'm lost without you. I hope you hear me. Come back, oh, baby, without you. You're a part of me.
That was an awesome performance.
It was.
By my man Brian Temba.
Yes.
On that note, we're gonna take a short break. Hashtag the weekend edition. We'll be back with some conversation and some food.
In the kitchen.
That's right. We'll be right back. Welcome back, guys. We're at the dining room table with the beautiful, gorgeous Zikhona Sodlaka.
Say it again.
Zikhona, did I say it right?
No, the part before.
The lovely, beautiful, gorgeous.
Oh, is that the part you want?
Oh, look, like, she's taking it in. What is happening?
Khanyi, I see you.
Yeah, you can see it.
Oh, okay. Well, welcome to the weekend edition.
Thank you, I feel very welcome.
Hi, guys, I'm
you guys know each other.
I'm on the table, right? I'm here.
You guys are crazy. You guys know each other, I see. Have you guys worked together before?
No, we're still praying for that to happen.
But I have done a show that she did before.
Yes.
You did show. After Nine.
Yes, and you were and me then, when I left.
And then she left, and then I took her seconds.
Yes.
What was After Nine? Was it a...
It was a series.
As in, you took over her character?
Yes.
You played the same character?
Yes. That's Z crazy. Z will now be played by Z.
Yes, I know you weren't aware. Yes.
Yeah.
Z will now be played by Z.
Why
now,
couldn't you make it, Kanye?
The pain, my man.
Oh. Oh, this was back in the Lamborghini days.
It's all about the money. Yeah. You know, it's about the money. It's about the money. The pain, right? You don't miss.
Wow, that is so crazy. Wow. Anyways, as we were saying, So wait, did you have to play it? Did you have to kind of do like study
no,
how
she... No. I think
the character changed.
Here I am cutting you right there.
Yeah.
I mean, second me here. The role of a performing artist is to play a character, not the person that played the character before she played it.
Yeah, but people have it in their minds who the character is, so but it's kind of jarring.
Those are not performing artists. It's people on the road.
It's not the thespian.
Yeah, it's not a...
Oh, so wait, okay, now we're talking thespian? Okay, so...
Yeah.
So, are we thespians?
Look at me, yes.
I don't know who you're...
Is she a thespian?
I myself
am. You're a thespian.
Yes, I am.
Did you study theater?
Yes, I did.
Oh, okay.
In the streets.
In the streets. Okay, you are a guest. Let's focus on you.
But before that, Joe...
Right. Oh,
she had a drive. She came through here in a nice car with our driver. And I'd love to know what you said and what you did in the car. Because there are a lot of questions and things that we ask our guests to do.
Yes, and say, and reenact.
Let's see.
Let's see.
So, Zikhona, welcome to the Weekend Sunday Drive.
Here are the cards that we're going to be playing. So you're just going to draw out a card, pick one, read it out loud, and let us know what you think about what's on the card.
What's my favorite home-cooked meal? It can't be my favorite, but it's one of the ones I like.
Mm-hmm.
My sister makes a mean mpokoko.
Okay, got you.
And masi.
Why does she make home mpokoko? What's so special about home mpokoko?
Isn't it fine? It goes fine.
How
it
fine is fine?
Laugh. There's no word of laugh in English, but fine.
It's fluffy.
Yeah. Ooh, yes. Okay, let me do it again.
Okay,
cool. My sister makes this fluffy mpokoko. Take your phone out and read the last message you received. It's actually one of my friends. She just texts now. She says, "Hey, sweets, I'm in the hood at 1 p.m. Are you free, maybe?"
Oh, that's a nice one.
She's one of my favorite people. Busisi walukha,
I
spoke. Clever. What's my favorite time of the day? Well, I'm a nocturnal.
You're a nocturnal person?
Yeah, it says why? Because I work better in the night. Khanyi or Phat Joe, once you pick, you must do your best impersonation of them. You know.
Yes. So much of the poise.
Décolletage.
Oh. Thank you. Stand corrected.
That's my opinion. Yes!
That was really good.
Okay.
That was really good.
Well, I'd like us to try and part together.
Shall we do it together?
Yeah, let's do it together. Come.
Please calm me down. What do I need? 5 or 6 or 4?
Four.
Okay. Yes.
But you both have to do it to camera, right?
Let's do the decolletage. Yes, don't do it too much. There's
you
meat.
Won't see mine. Okay, yeah. Just hold
no,
down.
But yours is drawing.
Okay.
Let's do this one. Okay. 1, 2, 1, 2. Wait, let me do the decolletage.
Okay.
And then count me down. Count us down, Joe.
Count us down, Joe.
3, which 2, camera? 1.
3.
Yeah! I even did that.
Yeah, you did. Did you get that? Did you breathe out?
Oh my gosh, Khanyi, it's so sexy to be you.
That part comes from the soul, from the God.
From the
inner.
You can't say in the
from
morning.
From the inner queen of blame.
Yes.
The inner queen of
blame. Yeah, that's why I can only try. Because yeah, I'm definitely.
From the inner queen of blame.
I'm definitely not the queen of blame.
Queen of blame, yeah.
But thanks for trying.
Far.
But you find him handsome. That's super cute.
But not attracted to.
Yeah.
Just handsome.
Just handsome.
Oh,
just
like, okay. No, that's. Yeah.
Very handsome.
Nice. Oh, thank you. Okay.
Very.
Thank you. let's talk about your career. You didn't. You actually studied business admin.
Yeah, I did business admin, and I did finance, and then I did computer programming.
Was that like for the parents? Was that what you wanted to do?
Yeah. Did you? Yeah, that was
what
for
are
the
you
parents.
Trying to say?
I'm gonna come to that. I'm gonna come to that. Yeah, that was for the parents. Also, I didn't know like how are you gonna. Study like performing arts. Like I was just from Mtata, and I just knew
you didn't even know that you could study performing arts.
Particularly, but yeah. That's gonna insinuate I'm older than I actually am. But like, it's not.
I mean, that's every kid, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I genuinely.
I studied engineering, computer science. That was me too.
Really?
Yeah. C++. Then, let's go.
Oh my God!
Cobalt, I
left it at a year.
Machine language.
I left it at a
year.
Oh,
okay, all right.
And just when we were starting C++, I had a young conversation with my lecturer. I was like, okay.
This is getting crazy.
Explain to me, genuinely.
Yeah.
What am I going to do for a living? Like, where will I work? So he's like, no, you're just going to find a computer, just going to do this one. I was like, delight. But I was doing good. So it's just like, it's one of those things where just because you're doing good at something doesn't mean.
Yeah. I knew at the time that computers, well, like the past 10, 15 years have just been about digital computers. I actually foresaw it coming. So I knew that that's where the high-paying, really cool, amazing work was going to come from.
At least you were
there. Stuff that was going to change the world, yeah.
At least you were there. Yeah. I was just there. Finish it, move on.
How did you end up acting?
Then, can I say it? Please, it's very cliche. It's the truth. Then I just fell into it. So I wanted to be a musician when it all started out.
Oh, so you sing?
Yeah, like, when she walked in here, she was singing.
I sing better than I do anything else.
What?
Yeah. So I'm
thinking. Do you sing or do you sing?
No, child, I both.
She both. Yeah,
no, it's what I am first.
Yeah.
That's why it's so like
you
most of the time.
You're through it.
Like
you,
though.
You sing, you act.
Like you, though. Because you, for me, being a performing artist is all of those things. You gotta be able to play a dancer, you gotta be able to play a singer if you can.
Right.
And then you gotta be able to play any other person. So that's what happened. Like when 11 years ago, I found myself done with the computer programming, and then my late sister.
Yeah.
She was like, so I think it's time. You're 19 going 20, pursue this. And then I did. Mm-hmm. And then I found a guy who showed me the Actors Theater. And then I found an audition that I sucked at, but I booked.
How did you make the transition? Because this is the hard part. You. Well, were you still studying? You didn't finish.
I didn't finish the last one.
But did you start working in computer?
No, I couldn't.
Oh, you never did.
Remember,
okay.
I'm 20. Okay, I'm first
you.
Year.
Got
I'm
you,
just like
got you. Okay.
Done.
All right.
So then the sister's just like, I think you're a little pretty, little.
Yeah.
Maybe do something.
Yeah.
And then I was just like, okay,
what? I don't know what language that was, but yeah.
It's a whole English.
Yeah, okay.
It's a whole English.
So how did you break in to the industry?
That's what happened. So what had happened was I finished the computer program. I drop it, the computer
program. You
programming.
Drop all of it.
Then she helped me find a representative. The trickiest part, and when people ask me, and I'm sure they ask both of you guys,
how do you break in?
Mm. You gotta find representatives, and the representatives you find need to teach you the correct stuff. They need to teach you to go to school. They need to teach you to go to some sort of training, even if it's Mam Dora's acting school. Because then you get taught a certain discipline, you get to understand what you're getting yourself into. And that's where I was fortunate. Mm. I got to know what I'm getting myself into when it comes to performance, acting particularly. There was a place at the Civic Theater, do you remember it? The Actors Center. And I kind of sort of just like hang out there.
Oh, okay, that was your spot.
Yeah, that's where they teach you the discipline. If you can't go to varsity, like, what is being an actor? Da-da-da-da-da, the whole shebang.
Wow.
And then I went to an audition, and I was just starting to get a hold of this whole thing, and I booked it. Wow.
What show was that?
That was Cha-Cha 4.
Get out of here.
I was this thin.
Aren't you still this thin?
No, she's...
Oh, yeah, no,
she's
she takes
another
the
level.
Cake, yeah. Yeah. She's on, like, yeah. Oh,
do you
wow.
remember? 2000 and...
I remember.
Yeah.
I remember.
2005
and
filmed,
five,
and then it
yes.
played in 2006. Yeah, that's how it all started.
Sure.
And now, what was the first movie you ever did? Have you done film? Yeah, I have to add, you know...
She's Madiba's mother.
Oh, yeah, well...
In a full Mandela film.
When I say, is that... I haven't seen... Which movie was that? Which one?
Mandela.
There's so many Mandela movies, I get
the
confused.
The real one with, what's his name? The
Idris Elba.
I haven't seen that. Oh,
she's
were you in
Mandela's
that movie?
Mother.
Okay, I didn't know that.
But
wow.
Khanyi, he's not even cultured.
That's right, we see you.
Mm. You know what it is?
I don't know.
I'm gonna explain.
Okay.
I wanted to watch the movie.
But Idris was
but
hotter.
Idris, no, when I saw, yeah, no, no, no.
Idris was darker.
I couldn't get past.
Like me, I don't watch films with black chicks. Like me, right?
That will be very few films you get to watch then.
I couldn't get past Idris as Madiba. I couldn't. Like,
it,
to
I,
me, that was just damaging for
taller.
Me.
So,
shout out to Idris, but it was just too much for me. I
so
couldn't.
I want to say something about that.
Yeah.
So, firstly, I'm playing with Idris, right?
Yeah.
And he's very hot. And a lot that felt like, why must we rub noses and not kiss?
Hey.
Because that's how he did it.
Yeah, you guys, yeah.
And a lot of other South African great actresses were in the film.
Yes.
Noctula Lidwaba was there. Terry Petto was there. That's to mention just a few. Ustandiwe Khoroge was there. Tony Khoroge was there. So they got a lot of great thespians in South Africa to be in the film. But Mandela wasn't South African. But I think... Perhaps, maybe, if South African money goes to South African stories, then we can get a South African
You know what?
Star.
I wasn't complaining because fully understood that this movie was actually made for the US market.
It doesn't make it right, though.
I didn't have an issue with that.
It doesn't make it right.
It doesn't make it right. I'm with you at that. So it's a catch 22 for me.
Is this that for me, like, having the history that I have, I just couldn't get past it. I couldn't.
I understand.
Why you said you're not going to watch it.
I couldn't bring myself to go buy a movie ticket, buy the DVD.
Imagine having to act in it. That's what I'm saying, is that
all the vocal coaching must have been crazy.
Yeah, and it's Xhosa. And
they spoke that together.
And I'm Xhosa, so you have to go...
And then he has to respond.
No, Idris.
That's not how you say it, Idris.
Shout out to Idris.
Idris,
so, you know what? I apologize, because I can imagine it was even tougher for you.
Yeah,
it had to be.
I want South African actors to play South African stories.
The beautiful thing about that is it obviously ended up playing in private quarters for... Not that it's that spectacular, but on a global scale, I guess it is. The Queen, the White House, this. Were you able to attend any of those events?
And then because it's American money, then the American stars shall cover the Queen.
Of course.
Yeah.
Literally. But then Tony Khoroge was a nice rap.
Shout out to Tony.
Literally. Shout out to Tony. Literally.
Okay.
Yeah, we
can. I guess he discovered Lupita.
Yeah,
Lupita.
Yeah, yeah.
Shout out to Tony. All right, guys, we're going to take a short break.
You're too much.
Zikhona is going to stick around and hang out with us for the rest of the show, as are you. Don't forget hashtag The Weekend Edition all across social media.
What are we cooking? Because it's a surprise.
It's a secret. Yeah, you have to figure that out for yourself. Okay. We'll be right back. We can. All right, guys, we're back in the kitchen. Chef Zama Memela is here, and today we're doing something completely different. Usually we try to inspire you with things to cook and make on a Sunday afternoon, but today she's gonna give us like some sort of taste test quiz.
And
what are we doing?
Determine if it's whatever it is.
So hold on. the thing is, there's a secret ingredient, right?
Ingredients,
and you've dedicated them to 2016, or what is it? Explain.
They have been dedicated to 2016, but before...
By whom?
By who?
Okay, we're getting ahead of ourselves. Okay, Paula, relax, okay.
I need you all to start right over here.
Okay. And what do? We just
grab a teaspoon.
Yeah.
Scoop something on this platter.
Yeah.
Put it in your mouth.
Why?
test it.
All right, okay. I'll go for the lentil.
Me too, I'm gonna go for the lentil. Okay, no, I'll go for the
olives.
Can I mix it?
Can I mix
it? You can, yes.
Should everybody do something different?
What's this one called?
Chickpeas.
I'll go, I'll have whatever Joe is having.
Mix, as what long as you
have whatever Joe is having, you're so silly.
Okay, I've got whatever this brine you
get in there. Can't hold back on this.
What is this, coffee?
Beans.
Beans. Brazilians like using the sponges a lot. Yeah?
They really do.
All right, so we eat it and then what?
Taste it, and then I want you guys to tell me what all these ingredients have in common.
Protein.
Good. Have you put it in your mouth?
No, it's just...
Come on.
I don't know.
What, the Mediterranean? Like, I don't know.
Yes.
Moroccan? I don't know. Why?
Okay, well, let me tell you. Let me fill you in.
Fill us in.
In 2013, the United Nations declared 2016 the International Year of the Pulses. And that's why we have variations of pulses, legumes. Oh, bonjis, lentil, chickpea, black bean, all of these ingredients fall under the category of pulses.
So and the cheese, is the cheese a pulse as well?
No, that's part of the dish that we're gonna make.
Oh, okay.
Focus on the
pulses. But what is a pulse?
A pulse is, it is these ingredients. The reason why they've been declared they've been declared part of the International Year of the Pulses is because that they're high in protein. And so the UN wants it to become part of the main source of protein.
You're deep
as
today,
well as
chef.
Other essential nutrients.
Is this the UN's idea to try and get us or wean us off of meat? Is that what it is?
Yes,
what this is?
But still take so care of your body at the same time.
Oh, you know, no more beef and more meat.
And more pulse.
If you season it right and you blindfold yourself.
So Brian is just saying that we're too...
But if you season it right.
In the culture of the Khoisans.
For those celebrations, those ceremonious moments, I mean...
Even every night.
Every night, guys. Have a bean. It's good for the digestive system.
You know what? If there's a drought and all the cattle are gone,
The chickens will never finish. Mediterranean. Okay.
All right.
We're making a Mediterranean quinoa.
Can you say that again? Quinoa.
Mediterranean quinoa.
Quinoa. We're making a Mediterranean.
We're queening Mediterranean style.
So, is this a salad that we're making?
Yes, okay. It is. But we're going to start with our balsamic dressing.
Is this full of protein as well?
That looks like ding, yo.
It does, right? It's got
a ding vibe to it.
Ding is sour, though. Sour, don't like ding. We like quinoa.
So what is that ding?
So that's quinoa.
That thing is called quinoa?
Yes. Do you want to taste it?
No. I'll taste it. Thank you, Khanyi.
Good girl.
None of us have ever had quinoa here, right?
I've
never had it either myself.
It's a part of the legume family.
Oh.
Couscous because of how it feels in your mouth. It's got that lightness, but no.
It's really nice, actually.
So for this dressing, I've got olive oil, balsamic vinegar, salt, black pepper. Joe, what you can do for me, please,
can you
just press these garlic cloves?
Just press them only.
Yes, just press
them. You don't want me to slice them?
And then you can finely chop them.
Okay, I'll...
Put all your weight on it.
Put all my weight on it, girl.
Yes.
You know me, I like to put the weight on it.
Aren't you just supposed to bruise them or...?
No,
because I want it to be inside your as well.
So I'm going to have garlic fingers after this. I love garlic fingers.
Wow, Joe. Me too, Joe.
Just herbs.
Girl, I'm mean in the kitchen. Don't play games with me. I might not know how to cut, but...
No, he is. Hit the looks.
Brian, can you cook?
Myself?
Yes.
I do.
I have no doubt you. But I was asking Brian.
I pray for a miracle.
Yeah.
Why do you not
pray for a miracle?
Maybe I do.
But do you actually cook the food?
Myself. I myself eat.
Okay.
You cook.
So that's a no to the cooking, guys. She don't cook.
I myself eat. Look, I can feed myself. Mm-hmm. It's just the pressure of cooking. That's the thing. So
what pressure, though? Like, you're not even afraid to dance.
You'll be able to make yourself something to eat and maybe your sister, because she's not going to judge you.
Of course.
But then now five
but
friends are coming
over. But when these people come over, we don't cook.
It's them that put the pressure. Now, I must know queen.
Yes. And this Quinn, eh?
This Quinn must go.
She reminds me of Rebecca Mandel. One of our most classic guests ever.
This is a dish that you'll be able to make when your friends come over. No pressure. just throw these ingredients together.
Can you
and
get this?
Like,
where do you get it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But can you buy this made? Can you get the queen done?
You can get it in a packet at the shop. There are instructions at the back of that packet.
On how to make the queen.
On how to make the queen.
Instructions. Okay. There's lots of cookbooks.
That's just water, though, right? You just put it in water, right?
Like rice.
Why do you cook really well?
Everything but a curry.
Really?
Everything but a curry. I've never tasted it, but he says that all the time.
How do you know for a fact?
What curry? Lamb curry.
I trust my roommate.
Chicken. I like lamb. I go crazy with the lamb.
What I go gaga for is a prawn curry.
I haven't baked in a while, but I bake also like a...
You bake?
Girl.
Look, he's good. He can make kids eat. Imagine a chef like this.
Can you please chuck this in there?
Kids wrong. Can you chef like this? All right,
cool.
So I'm just going to roughly chop this basil.
I can bake,
because
mama. I can bake.
I want to taste everything and see all our ingredients.
Right.
That's good to go.
I'm not helping. I just want you to know it's not because I don't want to help. It's two things. I like to watch you, Zama, but maybe Joe, and I don't know what to do.
Well.
So.
Should I whisk this?
We're going to queen out first. Yeah, whisk, please.
What's the dish called?
Mediterranean quinoa.
Quinoa.
Oh, so if you were using a couscous, it would be called the Mediterranean couscous.
Yes, this is our base, our foundation. Okay. Every plate has a foundation.
Mediterranean rice.
Okay. So Mediterranean rice, Mediterranean...
Mediterranean, you know what? If there's olives and feta, me, I call it Mediterranean. If there's olives and feta on that plate...
It makes it Mediterranean. Okay.
Is quinoa like a superfood or something?
Superfood, yes. It's got protein, fiber, it's a carb, so that's going to give you energy.
Yeah.
It's got magnesium, it's got folate, iron. You're winning here. You're queening here.
There you go, all right, you're queening. And this dish that you're making would be, because it's a salad, would this be sort of a main course or would this be more like a starter?
This would be great as a starter.
Yeah.
As a starter, but obviously in smaller portions. This is nice for if you're going to have like that everyone share at the table, pass the plate. Yeah. This is, platters are awesome for that.
I just never make it to my
grandparents. Thank you.
And then in go our chickpeas.
At the third person.
All right, let me help you with the big...
Even thank you. Leave the feta. Oh, okay.
No, you scoop it in.
Mediterranean quinoa.
Now, black bean.
All right.
Then some red lentil.
Okay.
Don't you like make up a quinoa song, Brian?
It's always strange. Red lentils are red when they dry, and then you cook them, and then
they're brown. I was about to say.
Yeah, Brian, like give us a queen.
Okay, okay. And then are we leaving the olives and the feta for
last?
For now.
You're gonna put that on top.
All right.
Please, Brian.
Please, Brian.
No, I don't want to disturb the process.
No, you won't.
You're not disturbing.
You're not
just
disturbing
say,
anything.
Kanye,
what is it they want Brian to sing while we cook?
They want me to sing.
Queen, queen.
Brian, if you're a woman, you came back from a gig. Daytime gig, you can sing in a studio session,
right.
And it's Sunday, and you walk in the house, and she presents something like this and says, this is lunch. Would you be smiling or would you be...
I'd be very smiling, yeah.
Can you smile with a diamond ring?
So this is the type you would eat this.
Don't just smile.
This is
smile with a
pressure.
I can smile.
No, I'd be smiling, definitely.
Yeah?
Really? Okay.
It looks good, man. And whatever.
Okay, it's not that difficult.
No, this is great for you to just chuck together in one place.
And is that sweet basil?
And just say you slaved away. That is basil, yes.
Okay.
I always say like slaved away.
Yeah.
Even on takeaways.
Yeah, especially takeaway. You pressed a button on the microwave and it went deet for a minute. That is slaving.
That is slaving.
What is wrong with your home?
Or like, have you ever like bought something and then you put it in the oven and warm it up
and then you put it in the oven and then you throw away and then throw away the takeaway far away.
And
then
what is it? You can't say this on TV and still want to get married. Do we still want to get married? Or are you just checking things?
If they don't marry us, we marry them.
All right, we have to cut the commercial break. But before we do, how are you going to finish this dish?
So this is going to add some rocket, feta, olives, dressing, voila.
It is done.
Yes.
All right, and then we're going to taste test it a little bit later on, all right? Mm-hmm. Right now, we need to take a short break. The Weekend Edition, we'll be right back. Don't forget all our recipes on our Facebook page, The Weekend on 3.
What?
It's a weekend, yeah. It's a weekend, yeah.
Welcome back, guys. We are now feasting on the...
Mediterranean quinquin salad.
Quinquin salad. How's it taste, Brian?
I'll tell you just now.
Where's right, your plate?
How does it taste, Joe?
Yeah? He's nodding his head.
Ring,
well,
right?
While they try and taste what? And check out the food that we've just made, Tabby Samjoy is a young designer who's a trailblazer. She hung out with Brett, showing her some of her award-winning designs. Let's check it out and see what she's up to.
Northcliffe is home to views of Johannesburg, trees, and Tabby Samjoy. Tabisa is a young South African designer who makes beautiful items with a very South African flavor. Let's go meet her.
Tabby Samjoy is the founder of Mash Tea Design Studio and talented creative in her own right. She won the Nando's Hot Young Designer 2015 competition with one of her lighting designs and continues to specialize in interior spaces for the hospitality and retail sectors, although her firm has recently branched out into furniture design too.
Tabby, so you first came to my attention when you were chosen as an awesome woman for a women's magazine. What does it mean to you to be an awesome woman, first of all? And also, are you a designer, you're an interior designer? How do you define yourself?
For me, being an awesome woman means being gutsy and ballsy and going for whatever it is that you want, just realizing your own agency. And the whole title, so I'm not big on titles, but I like to consider myself a designer. I don't want to limit myself to one sort of stream of design. I just like to create, and whether that is creating a beautiful interior space or a product, and just a creator.
So design and creativity is non-traditional form of income, I suppose. How did your family react to you being an artist?
So lucky, because my family is really supportive. And they did not look at it as design, but they looked at it more as entrepreneurship. And it's something my dad had been dabbling in for years, so it wasn't a foreign concept to them. And my sister's also an entrepreneur. She'd been at it for a good 4 years before I jumped ship as well and joined her. So they were extremely supportive because it wasn't a foreign concept to them.
How did you get into interior designing? If you're into creation, you've found most of your success through interior design. How did you get into that?
So I studied at AFDA. I majored in production design. And before I went to AFDA, I had no idea really about interior designers and product designers. But when I started working in the TV and film industry, I started noting, whenever I'd go out, luxury restaurants or hotels, I found myself paying so much attention to the spaces and being curious about who are these people who put this together. And I loved the idea, and as much as I enjoyed production design, I loved the idea of creating spaces that would be lived in and that could be experienced by the masses. And so I decided to go back to school. I went to Inkscape Design School, and that's where I studied interiors and architectural drawing. And I started running my business 2013.
So recently the world is becoming more aware that young black women have been put at a disadvantage historically, and how has that informed your story, and what have you learned from that?
Mm-hmm. I think for any entrepreneur, right? So the biggest challenge is access to market. I know when you start out, you think, oh, my biggest challenge is finance, I need financing. But no, you don't, I think. You need access to market. So that's one thing that faces all entrepreneurs. And then to be a woman and to be a black woman at that, it makes it that much harder because the expectation is she couldn't possibly do it. When I entered the competition, it was not about, you know, how many years you've been in the business and who you are and who you know. It was literally about the work. And for Nando's, your work speaks for itself. And I'm really excited to be getting to a point in my career where it's no longer about the fact that, oh, she's a black woman and that's a disadvantage. It's not. Now it's, oh, she's a black woman, so let's hear her story and how, and most importantly, how does her story influence her work?
All right, so enough talking about design. Let's see some of your design.
Yeah, sure, Brett, let's. So, Brett, these two lights are part of my new collection, which we exhibited at 100% Design earlier this year. So this is called the Black Dodi Lamp. And let me just put that on for you quickly. And this is called the Nomkana Lamp. Nomkana Lamp, yeah.
I tried so hard.
You did. So I thought, exactly, at least you tried. So the Black Dodi Lamp was inspired by a childhood game. Dodi is tin in Xhosa, so hence the name Black Dodi. And I loved So this material, this PVC material, just really reminded me of a can. And I love the idea of mixing really non-conventional materials with materials that are a little bit more expensive looking.
It's really interesting to see them together, especially the traditional bag fabric and this beautiful copper.
Yeah.
It's really a nice juxtaposition together.
Exactly.
And I love how you can see through the through the actual, through the tin, I suppose.
Yeah, yeah.
I see there's that one as well, which is...
Yes, so this is the 2.0.
It's beautiful, and that's it's not simple, but it's the ingredients are there, like it's some steel and some wool. And
exactly.
You just have to have the forethought and courage to design something.
Exactly, exactly. And the actual design itself really is how it flares out. So the design is not the wool or the finishing. So I like to think of the metal, I like to think of that as the skirt. And the wool or whatever finishing we put on the skirt is the print. Because the whole idea is that with your print, you're never limited.
You can just change your clothing.
Exactly.
Change your tutu.
Change your tutu, yeah.
Well, a beautiful and inspiring day. Thank you for showing us your amazing designs and for educating us a little bit on business and how to get ahead and how to, you know, have a bit of chutzpah.
Oh, yeah.
Have some chutzpah. Yeah. Have some vuma. We're in South Africa.
Yes.
Amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Paige. So. Thank you for coming.
I totally understand and see why she's an award-winning designer. Her designs are pretty.
That's right. Sitting next to us, man, is our musical guest, Brian Temba. 20 years in the game, man. Sure. 20 years. I hate
almost
to put you on blast.
20 years, man.
Okay. How many
almost,
years is it?
Not yet.
Yeah?
It's close to 20 years.
It's close. Yeah. It's very close. I started in 1998.
1998.
Yes, sir.
98. I feel I was there. I'm just trying to remember what was that first single, because I know we played it at YFM.
Yeah.
What was your first single?
But you see that was 2009.
Oh, that was later.
So what music were you making in 1998?
In 98, what were you doing?
Gospel, man. I was part of Joyous Celebration. I was part of Family Factory.
That was when Joyous was actually Joyous.
Yes.
The greatest
I didn't
music.
Say that.
No, I said it. I said I put out there that was when Joyous was Joyous.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's when I started.
1998.
Yes, sir.
Oh, and how big was Joyous at that time? I mean, in terms of membership and musicians.
There was a lot of us.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a lot of us. I'd say Joyous Celebration is a beautiful platform for singers. Mm. You know, because they showcase talent more than anything. So I started there, man.
And obviously you get to travel to some very interesting places around the world when you're part of a troupe like that. What are some of the more memorable performances that you've had?
Well, not around the world, but nationally.
Oh, okay, nationally.
Nationally, yeah. One of the memorable performances that I've had was at Market Theatre. The first time I actually sang a lead. I was a lead in a song, and I sang Uthando Lukababa. Mm. And it was amazing, man. They spoke about it on Metro FM for the whole week.
Really?
Romeo Kumalo was on radio that time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it was an amazing experience for me. So
wow.
I don't even... It was the first time. And
so,
I don't forget it.
Let's just go back. You're from Soshanguve, right?
Yes, sir.
And how did you end up joining Joyous?
Right, so this story is...
Is it long?
It's a funny story.
Oh, okay.
No, it's not long. It's not too long. In 1997... Vicky Vilagazi came to our church and sang, and I was like, wow. And Family Factory came, and I was like, what? I want to be part of that. I want that. And while I was in college in 97, I used to write down, I want to sing Joyous Celebration and Family Factory, and I want to record my first album overseas.
Oh, you wrote this stuff down in
all
your dorm room?
All of that down.
Yeah,
yeah.
There was no direction of me going overseas. I didn't even see the light. I didn't know nobody overseas. But I used to write those things down. So this was 97. 98, Vicky Vilagazi hunted me down because she wanted me to be one of the backing singers.
Mm.
From then, it was Joyous Celebration, Family Factory, and then in 2000, I went to L.A.
So you created a script for yourself and you actually lived it out?
Yes.
Wow.
What were you doing in L.A.?
I was doing The Lion King for about 2.5 years.
Wow.
Yeah, man.
Was that that must have been the first production?
No, that was the third production.
Was it the third production?
The first production was Broadway, second production was London. The West End, which I was part of.
I've been to the West End performance.
When?
Late. It was like 7 years ago, 8 years ago. Were you part of that?
Probably, yeah.
What character did you play, though?
I played, okay, so in L.A., I was part of the ensemble. Yeah. And I auditioned in 2000 and, what was, what's this? Yeah, 2003, to play the lead part. We were moving from L.A. to Chicago.
Yeah.
But because of the laws, you know, equity laws and whatever, I couldn't play it in the States. So they took me to London to play Simba in the West End.
2008, was that you?
This was me.
I went to go see that performance.
So you saw him there,
And shout out to Lebo M. He got me some amazing seats because it was sold out. I couldn't get seats, but I through him, he hooked me up. Yeah.
Yeah. So I got to do that for about 5 years, which was an amazing experience, man.
Wow, that is incredible, man. What a small world. And now you do motivational talks?
Yeah. Time and again, I go to young people. You know, last time I went to Tembisa High, and I spoke to the 12th graders, right? It's in a metric.
Yeah.
So I don't get this 12th
gone,
grade.
Right? Yeah.
12. So, yeah, I was talking to them and just motivating them and all of that. And 2 weeks back, I was actually at a church just speaking, because my passion right now is about parents or fathers and their kids, fathers and their boys. We as a black nation, we grow apart. You know, we don't have that. You never have a one-to-one with your dad. You never experience your dad telling you that they love you.
Yeah.
You know
even
what I'm
girls,
saying?
Even with our mothers.
You see what I'm saying?
It was a problem, yeah.
So one thing that I want to talk about a little bit more is about that, or how parents need to give their children love, how parents need to tell their children who they are, because we leave home not knowing who we are. We find credit in the streets. You know, my boys used to tell me, hey, you know?
Yeah.
That was the props that I got, and that was the only, you know, motivation or validation that I got from the street.
Yeah.
But I never got it from home. So, and this is what we suffer from.
And why do you think that is? I mean, my dad was, he was great, but he was also one of those hard parents as well. He could never say, I love you. Like, only towards the end.
My dad too.
Only towards the end. Well, he passed away last year, so it's only when he was really sick that he could kind of start saying, I love you. But it was awkward.
It was,
And if he wasn't disciplining you, it was like very difficult to have a conversation. And I never understood that.
I never understood it as well.
Why do you think that is, Khanyi?
I don't know. I just think it's from their parents as well. Their parents didn't tell them either. So I think for them, when you're a parent, you need it to just be that form of authority beyond giving any affection.
It's important. I believe it's important, even though we know our parents love us, but we need to hear it sometimes. Mm. Even though we know that they want the best for us, but sometimes we want them to sit with us and tell us who we are.
Yeah.
Because it's important. If you don't know who you are, if you don't know that, you know, if I need to treat a woman this way.
Yeah.
We've made so many mistakes, especially with our women.
Yeah.
And our parents aren't affectionate in front of us.
That's what I'm saying. And we need to see all of that so that if I'm dating somebody, I know that I need to date with just one person. You know what I'm saying? And just be able to just tell them how I feel, because I saw it from my parents.
Yeah.
You know?
Wow. You brought up the parenting thing. We were just talking about kids now. I don't know if you want to get into it, but you're sort of like a long-distance dad right now, right?
I am.
Yeah? How's that going?
It's hard.
It's hard, eh?
Yeah, it's the worst thing ever.
I went through the exact same thing. We were talking about this off-air, and I always say that it seems like every man of our generation has to go through that, and it's like, when I was, because my son also lived in the UK, and I felt like, why me, why me? And it's only when I realized that it's not just me, and it's not even just about me.
Right.
It's just something I have to go through, that's when things kind of started to work out for me. So how often do you see your daughter?
Two or three times a year. Oh, I go there or I have to go get her so I can bring her back, because it's important for her to know who she is.
Has it been like that since she was born, or?
Because I have dual citizenship, so I go to London. I lived in London for 7 years. I used to live there until I had to leave. I left when she was five.
Okay, I got you. Wow, man. Wow. And then how things going with, are you still on Muvhango, right?
Yes.
Yeah, how's that going?
Man, it's awesome. It's awesome.
Yeah?
It's something that I never really thought I would do, actually. You know, because I was just getting into music. I wanted to do music.
Mm.
I was convicted by music.
Yeah.
And then that's all I wanted to do. But it's interesting that music just took me to a different direction. I mean, for me to do Lion King, I never planned to do that.
Right.
That was not in the cards. It's just, I just wanted to sing.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how God just places everything in order.
Right. Yeah, mm-hmm. That is so cool, man. There's so many questions I want to ask you. You're going to stick around and hang out with us, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Brian is going to be here for the rest of the show, but should we go to a performance or go to an ad break?
Let's go to an ad break.
All right, we're going to pay some bills right now. Don't forget, we are hashtag the weekend edition all through our social media. We got some more great performances from our man Brian Temba coming up. It's a weekend, yeah. It's a weekend. Welcome back, guys. It's the weekend edition. Thank you so much for joining us. Now, we like to show you all kinds of interesting things. We love the arts. We like to show you things you can partake in. We love homemaking. And today, we've got something interesting to show you.
Yeah, well, Brett met up with an interesting guy called Nicholas. He's into pottery and spreading the word about being creative with the makers movement. So Brett hung out with him, and they made a rather rustic little bowl. Let's check out how that went.
We don't make things anymore. We buy soulless items by the thousands from department stores. So I'm here at Ashley Christella Ceramics, where they don't make things by the thousands. And I'm here to meet Nicholas Kusaris, who's passionate about pottery, and more importantly, making things.
Although his day job is in a different creative field, Nicholas can physically manifest ideas through pottery, and is enthusiastically sharing the work of the makers movement in his hobby.
Right, so I'm just gonna turn on the wheel here and start with a pretty small piece of clay. This would be enough for a mug or a large cup, something like that. Just slap it down in the middle.
Is that slap part of the fun?
Yeah, it definitely is. And it's actually necessary because otherwise the centrifugal force will push the pot off while you're in the middle of forming it. So I'm just lubricating my hands with water and the ball has to be perfectly centered on the board.
Did it take a long time to really get into it and work out what you're doing, or was it quite an easy process?
Just the centering part itself actually takes a good few sessions to master because you need to develop a kind of touch where you can tell whether it's spinning truly or not. So as you can see it now, there's still a slight wobble in it, and a lot of people wouldn't pick that up on their first few tries.
And what's next in the process?
So the next stage is to open the ball to create a kind of shallow cylinder or bowl shape. And this you also have to do very precisely. Right, so, I mean, that's a basic pot right there.
How long have you been doing it? What drew you to it?
I've been throwing on the wheel for 2 years now. So I'm just gonna do a few more pulls to get the height.
It looks so soothing while you're doing that. Do you enjoy the process? Is it quite meditative?
I find it incredibly relaxing, first of all. And I also just love the creative process, starting with something that's, you know, little more than a ball of mud or dirt, and making something beautiful with nothing more than that ball of dirt and an idea in your hands. So that's what really draws me to this as a craft. Yeah, I'm pretty happy with that shape, so I'm just gonna slide the bat off the wheel head.
Do you mind if I give it a bash?
The potter's wheel dates back to around 3000 BC, and there's even an ancient Egyptian myth of the deity Khnum, forming the first humans on a potter's wheel.
Okay, smash it down in the middle. Nice, that was a good throw, actually. Okay, so now what you have to do is wet your hands. And in a squeezing motion, with your left hand pressing down and your right hand pressing inwards, spin the wheel and keep your forearms touching the wheel head. Put a lot of pressure on it, a lot of strength. Let's have a look. Okay, I reckon we could probably work with that. Okay, so now what you're gonna do is use a scissors motion with your thumbs and push your thumbs into the middle. Okay, now open them up a little until you have the size of... Yeah, if it starts sticking, always more water.
I'm a natural, Nicholas.
You are a natural.
Look how beautifully I did that.
Cool.
Okay, so what next? Do we take it off now?
Right, we can't take it off now because we didn't use the wooden bat that we used before. We threw directly onto the wheel head here. So it'll distort if we try and move it now. So we're going to give it a few minutes to just rest and dry and firm up a little. And then we'll take it off and keep working on it.
Cool, thanks, Nicholas.
Pottery has a number of therapeutic benefits, from stress relief and creating calm focus to sensory and fine motor skills development, especially for children and adults with special needs.
Once the pieces are dry, they have to go into two firings. The first is called the bisque firing, which goes to about 800 or so degrees, and that'll harden it. It'll get the water out of the clay. There's chemically bonded water in those molecules. So it gets rid of all of that water, and it gives you a good, hard, smooth, absorbent surface for your surface decoration.
800 degrees.
Yeah, and that's just the first firing. In the second firing, where you glaze and decorate, it goes to 1,260 degrees.
So we're not making cakes in here?
No, not the regular cakes.
If nothing else, pottery teaches patience, as it takes time for clay to dry, be painted and fired in the kiln. The advantage is that it offers freedom of expression in creating and decorating.
So you can see the kiln is heating up 390 degrees. Soon we'll be firing up my little sugar bowl and we'll have something really beautiful in a couple of weeks' time.
It's astounding to see how a ball of clay transformed into an imaginative or functional piece of art, but it's all part of the joy of pottery.
Sorry it was late. Ceramics are an exercise in patience. Sounds like my life. Let's have a quick look. Ta-da! Pretty, huh? All my sugar.
All right, very cool, man. So we've got Brian Temba, who's our, I always want to say Temba. I feel like the B is silent.
Yeah, Temba.
I want to just put a little twang. It's Brian Temba, who's our musical guest here today, and he's performed a couple of songs for us. Here's one of them, take a look.
This song we wrote because we were giving props to every, you know, girl in the hood, every girl that's named Zanele Zodwa, but we just went with Zanele. So here's Zanele.
One, two, three. Town.
Fantastic. Brian Temba. I'm doing it again.
You're doing it again.
Temba. Yeah, Temba. We're going to take a short break. Hashtag the weekend edition. We'll be right back. It's a weekend.
Welcome back. We're still sitting at the table with Zikhona to speak more about music meets dance and meets her career woman type of thing. Hey?
Yes.
So you're good friends with Brenda?
I am I'm a great fan of her work.
Oh, you're a great fan, not friends?
Yeah.
Oh,
no, okay. Not friends. Oh, yeah.
Because I was about to ask you, how is she? Because I speak to her like once a year.
You used to work with her.
Yeah.
I don't speak to her as often.
Oh, okay.
To call
she won an Emmy Award, right?
She's amazing.
She did. Yeah. She's crazy.
She's amazing. Very few people can do what she can do. She's like,
really?
She's like on a Viola Davids.
Yeah,
tip.
No, she's like, on another tip.
She's on another level. Mm. She's absolutely amazing. I
mean, but get on her bad side. Ooh, I've seen her.
I've been on her bad side a few times.
No, she's not afraid. Oh yeah.
You never on the show.
Yeah, she was. That's
right. What did you do? Press.
No, she had no fear of telling her. She was not happy with the Queen of Bling persona, and she let her have it.
And on the phone, we were having.
She let you have it. Yeah.
But I love her. I still love her.
Really?
Yeah. Mm.
That's not your persona anymore.
What? No, but that then.
Yeah. Oh.
Then, not now.
We don't
get in politics. No.
We've worked together on a production.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
that was then, 2006. Yeah. And, you know, it was perhaps tamer then.
Yeah.
No, but she's amazing.
Yeah.
But speaking of amazing, you were not a judge as such, but you presented a show that gave other actors an opportunity to get into the industry.
Yes.
How was that, being on the other side, being an actress as you are, watching young people trying to do this thing and winning a career?
You have to tell some people no, you can't.
She had to be rough. Mm. Yeah, I host, I still do. I host and judge this show called Top Actor Africa.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So what we do is we go to different countries in the African continent, find actors, bring them down, put them in one house, 12 of them, and shoot 12 different, or 10 different genres. Yeah. And we get a South African star and a Hollywood star to come and be my guest.
Would you say, do you guys get Nigerians as well?
Yeah, yeah.
Everything around
would
Africa.
Would you say the Nigerians are the most competitive, given the size
Absolutely.
Of their industry?
Absolutely.
Yeah? It's like life or death.
We had two contestants from Nigeria this season that's repeating now. Hmm. And they made it to the top five. And even then, they were just like, I need to make it to the top three. I need to make it. There was two of them. It was a girl and a guy. And it was completely different. The women are actually much more competitive, as far as I've noticed. Am I wrong? Like, the women want it more. Yes. They are not afraid. They go get it. They are vocal. Mm. And I think maybe it's because a woman is not expected to get as much as maybe a man could ordinarily. Mm.
I would beg to differ. I mean,
how?
I would say the one area which is the one business which is equitable across the board is acting, because you cannot just have all women and all men. It really has to reflect. So I feel like there's a balance. And then
it's so nice to say that because you're a man. But I promise you, the back foot is something that you still come from as a woman performing artist. We don't even get paid as equally with the guy.
True.
You will really? Be, yeah, true. I myself.
But you guys, for the most part, I find you guys are more often the
we
stars.
We have to be the stars, and that's recent. If you look back, we've been the stars in like the past 5 years, really?
Yes.
Where there's female-led shows, female-produced shows. Maybe, yes, it's been there. I won't say it hasn't been there. But it's recent. It's always been male-led. And it's the time. The time is now. Women must get paid as much as the guy gets paid and get equal opportunities, and not write a woman as a wife.
Or a girlfriend.
We were just talking
about
this earlier, that the woman's going to be a lead because her husband's the lead.
Yes. Or she's the love interest.
Yes, or the concubine.
Yeah.
Or the queen because the king died.
Yes.
There's like...
Or the widower that lost the husband.
Yeah, it's played out. Real life has women doing things.
Why are you laughing, Joe?
Say it.
As a male, I can't find myself. I haven't seen all the female-led superhero movies that I've seen. For example,
Storm.
I find I'm like, You know what I mean? Like, as a guy, I'm just, like, not interested.
Yes, yeah.
But then, it's not that I'm chauvinistic. It's just that my idea of a superhero...
It's not because you're white.
It has nothing to do with chauvinism.
It's got nothing to do with that.
It absolutely has nothing to do with chauvinism.
So what, women can't be superheroes?
No, you can be superheroes, but then women must support those. Because I support the male superhero films. You must support the female. Do you get what I'm saying?
Also, we shouldn't cross the line.
But the female superhero stories have got nothing to do with men. Why must you have an input in that?
Exactly, that's what I'm saying.
But you don't need to have an opinion and a perspective about the fact that a woman's superhero story is led by a woman. You can just sit back and just watch it.
So
you
don't need to can never like have a woman.
The point
you
I'm can't, making.
You don't need to like it.
Here's the point. I know I'm delving into very dark waters right
you
now.
You are.
The point I'm making is this. Film, TV, any form of entertainment, you're speaking to a specific audience. So, like, for instance...
So I can't speak to men as a superhero?
Let's be clear. Romantic comedies and acting are made for women, predominantly.
No.
Men who go watch romantic comedies...
Let's try and listen to what his point, if there's one.
A man will take his woman on a date to go see a romantic comedy. Guys won't be like, hey, Buffett, there's this new romantic comedy. Let's go check it out as a group of guys. Or never. Like, it just doesn't work that way.
It does work that way.
That's what I'm saying.
Therefore, Joe.
Yeah.
There's no market for films that are made for women that are leading.
No. There is a market.
So why are we discrediting?
The point I'm making is women... Okay. The point I'm making is that there are some genres that women support and maybe should support because it's actually made for... You can't make a female superhero film.
Your opinion
I'm going to sit there and be
so
like, She-Ra, go. No,
so you're never
going
to go watch She-Ra and go, go,
no,
She-Ra,
never.
Go.
And the great thing is that then they're not made for you. Don't watch
exactly.
it.
Exactly.
Don't watch
it's
it.
Like the Madiba, it's like the Madiba film. Joe, because I'm South African, I can't watch.
Another
can't
American
watch. That's for the American audience. That's for them. They must support it.
So then don't watch it and don't have an opinion about it.
That's exactly. But we're having a discussion about chauvinism, and so I'm trying to ask.
No, you are being chauvinistic about an opinion that has got nothing to do.
I had no idea that I was like Donald Trump.
Yeah, you are a Donald Trump. He exists.
Let's move on.
Right now.
You call yourself a foodie. Do you call yourself a foodie?
Yeah, perhaps, because I eat.
Because she's
food,
cooked
yeah,
for it.
Traditional foods is more your thing, right? No, I'm asking.
Like, you know what? I mean, I wouldn't say I cook urban foods. Like, I don't know how to do what the chef is going to be like. Doing and yeah, I cook good. I cook food that feeds. Oh, I don't cook.
There she said it. She doesn't cook. She's not a foodie.
I don't cook. I just prefer.
No, it says here you love to travel and you call yourself a closer foodie. Is that true?
Eat the food.
What are some
not
of your favorite foods?
Food.
What are some
make
of
the foods?
What are some of the foods that you like?
Yeah, but then, you know, we spoke about the foods that I like to eat in the insert when we were driving here. Like,
right.
And I said, you know, I like. My normal foods, like firstly, I can't eat red meat, I can't take lactose stuff, so I have to eat boring vegetable food and then, and like traditional food.
Why is it like this is a dangerous topic?
Because when you say
the
pressures of food is like, wow, like,
oh, okay.
And you make the food.
All right.
No?
Okay, cool. All right, then fine. We'll take a short break because I think we're
a
both sweating. we're going to pay some bills right now. Hashtag the weekend edition. We'll be right back just after this.
But she still thinks you're cute.
I don't
Thank
know.
Thank you, sir. Welcome back to the Weekend Edition. Brian is here. He's asking for cooking lessons from me. But first, I think you need to pass Zama's kitchen.
Finally, he does something, though.
Yeah.
I'm here.
Thank you.
You're just standing.
Yeah, he's present. No, well...
It's hard work, huh?
It is.
So what are we making here?
Here, we're going to highlight the pulse lentil by making a tomato and basil lentil chutney with taco with guacamole and salsa.
Sounds nice.
Kanye, you're gonna make the chutney.
Okay.
The tomato and basil chutney. Okay, so some oil in the pan, and then you're gonna chuck in your tomatoes and this chili. Brian, sweet Brian, you're gonna get started on the salsa. So I need you to chop these tomatoes really, just about the same size as the onions. Everybody's got a task.
Are you gonna take the salt when you try to chop, or do you need to help
Here is your tool of life.
This is tool of death, man.
What are you doing? Did you see the way
don't cut yourself.
And he held it to you, so I'm like, Zama, are you crazy?
You need me to pass this kitchen so you can pass that kitchen.
Brian, get the chopping man. Like
so what do I do here? Do I wait for it to get warm?
For it to get hot, because we want the tomatoes to seal. We don't want it to just absorb the fat.
You need some space on the board. Okay, let's keep it on. Do it on the board. Do it on the board.
That board, yes. Brian, do it right, because Joe gets emotional.
I know, like you're so passionate about it.
Yeah.
No, I'm worried about your safety. I want you to look good. He hasn't cut anything yet. He's just like been talking. Like nothing.
So we've got chutney going, salsa going, and then I'm going to start the guacamole. And then I'm gonna pass it over to Z.
What am I doing?
To make some guac.
Oh, okay.
Have you ever made guacamole before?
Yeah.
Okay, we're popping cherries today. All right, then. Okay.
Yeah,
in there.
Yeah.
In the thingamabob.
And yeah, you can actually just do it from over there so you can be comfortable.
I am so nervous about this part.
You're gonna scoop,
easy part.
Scoop the avo out into the bowl.
What you don't want it to cube it or anything like that?
Mm-mm. And then you're going to mash it with a fork. But we don't want it to be too fine. We want it to be chunky. It'll add texture to the final product.
Okay, cool.
Okay. How are you going there, Ma?
Sizzling, babe.
Sizzling. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then here's your chili. And then add the sugar. This is brown sugar, so that it can have that caramelized effect.
How much sugar does she add? The whole bowl?
Pour. I'm the kind of chef, like, I measure with my eyes, unless there's a recipe, and there ain't no recipe in my kitchen.
I'm gonna keep going until you say stop.
Keep going, Mom.
I'm gonna keep going.
Keep going.
Are you
sure? It's a chutney. Keep going. Stop.
Also, chutney is that thing you call ipisto?
Ushatin.
Yes.
Oh,
okay.
Is it?
Yes. Ushatin. Yeah. Chutney, ushatin.
Pisto.
Yeah. Pronunciation, there's no master.
Done.
Mm-mm. Here's more.
Oh.
There you go.
What are you doing?
Like
how is it coming there, Brian?
Brian,
it doesn't need to be
in the chance, guys. Get Brian. And then you're going to squeeze the lime into there as well.
Okay.
And then Kanye's going to need some basil because it's a tomato and basil chutney.
So can I add anything if I'd like to obviously create my own? Am I allowed to?
Always. In the kitchen, chuck it in, give it a title. As long as it tastes good, that's all that matters. Okay. People won't ask you so often.
What would you want to add to that? Like
egg. I'd add egg.
Onion. I don't know.
You'd add egg.
We'll make a nice, breakfasty situation.
I'd add onion. I don't know.
A breakfast taco.
Yes.
She thinks she's done something. Now. She's like, You just created a breakfast taco.
Okay, cool. Here's your basil, Kanye.
Kanye would add a burger in there.
No.
Oh my gosh.
Whole burger. You just
wow.
So go with your tomato and basil chutney is that you need a chutney spice. So you would have taken poppy seeds, mustard seeds, cumin, pistachios, dried chili flakes, and you would have toasted it in a pan, and then you'll get what you call your
pistachios
chutney
spice. Pistachios are nuts, right?
Yes.
So we throw them in here as well.
You throw them inside there, but I've already made it, and I've toasted the spices, and I've blended it, and then you get this like nice spice.
So let's say you don't have everything else. Let's say you don't have everything else. You have pistachios only. What would you put in there?
You would put aromatic in there.
Yeah, she would.
MSG.
MSG. Anything else that you have in your cupboard that has a nice flavor, hopefully if you combine it, it'll taste nice. But always taste it before you mix it into the
because the important part is to remind us that it's all about having a nice taste in the end.
At the end of the day.
A healthy taste. Because
in the kitchen.
She's still thinking about the
MSG.
MSG. No MSG, please.
All right.
And then some salt and pepper, always to taste.
How much of the salt and pepper?
A pinch of salt.
Like that?
Yes, and then just crush, that's salt, and then
genuinely,
give it a jiggle.
I'm not looking.
There you go, good, that's good. And then what's
Brian,
the
are you still on that first tomato?
No.
Yes.
Okay. And that would have been our chutney
done.
Get that simmer.
Is that fine enough? It's a little bit chunky.
No, Baba. You're doing a great job.
Joe, you're
just
being hard.
Just a little bit finer. It's Angel King.
He's got on glasses
stay
and everything.
Stay in your lane. Okay, just chop it. Just
she
chop this,
fine.
What you've
I
got.
Heard the
so about the same size of the onion.
Okay. I'm done.
Okay, yes, so if you push your knife down and you balance it with your fingers at the front, and then you can just kind of groove
see,
with it.
I've done this before, Joe.
This chutney looks good.
You have not done this before.
So let this simmer for about 10 minutes, and then you'll have your lentils that you would have already cooked for about 30 to 40 minutes in water that you would add vegetables.
Ooh, that's the thing.
Flavor,
that's
flavor, yeah.
And then let that cool, puree it, and then mix it together.
So is that the final?
Oh, this is the final product of the tomato and basil chutney.
So the, okay.
So it becomes a tomato and basil lentil chutney when you add the lentil to the tomato and basil chutney.
And then you puree the whole thing.
Yes. No, you puree the chutney.
Okay.
So now the lentils, you don't want to puree the lentils because you still want texture in your meal.
Okay.
What's the definition of just a chutney in general? What are the main ingredients? Obviously sugar and what else?
It is onion.
Onion.
Tomato.
Chili.
Chili.
Basil. Salt, pepper, sugar. Create your own version
so
by adding
when
other
I buy
ingredients.
Like a peach chutney, it's those ingredients with some peach in it.
Oh yeah, you're right.
Mm. I mean, I'm just asking.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right. Yes. Yeah. So then isn't a chutney just a mix of things that you like and then you can call it a chutney?
As long as there's tomato in it.
It's a chutney.
It's a chutney, ma.
Prawn chutney. Okay. I'm coming.
All right.
Lamb chutney. Lamb chutney. Chicken chutney.
And then add fruit chutney to this mix.
Mm. What are you adding? Sorry?
Fruit chutney.
That's not what we're making there.
No, because you would have added
chutney
this
on a chutney.
Yes, you would have added this in the final product after you've pureed that.
Okay.
Okay.
So a fruit chutney would be all of this with fruit in it?
A fruit, yes, and then add your fruit of choice.
Well, I don't know if I would make this again, but I'm constantly learning what to do with different foods all the time because I like being in the kitchen.
I think your tomato is good now. Good to go.
So
in here, you can add all of these ingredients.
You hear that?
Oh, there you go.
You hear that, Joe? You hear that?
And then
finally.
Z, you guys, I feel like
I did it though. I put the lime in here.
Here you go. Yes, you did, love, but now you're adding this as well.
Zama, you know the kids who used to take the special bus to school? This is us.
this is all of them, right?
Yeah, we need
those
extra time and a little bit of.
When a person is used to being cooked for and such, then they have to handle the food themselves.
It's a problem.
But you guys are doing a good job, you know?
Okay, cool.
Thanks, Joe.
Brian?
Thanks, man. Thanks.
I need you to help me assemble
the special bus.
It's nice to know that talented people are deficient in certain areas. You know? It makes them
everything.
It makes them human.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't dance.
Okay.
No, actually, I can't.
No, you can. He's a break dancer.
He just didn't want to? Let's add some sugar.
No, he was giving you guys a chance.
You can for real.
It's a shine.
Yeah, like on the floor.
Girl, if you trust me. Trust me. Trust me.
You throw down.
Salt.
Yeah.
Trust in me.
Give it a stir. Nice salsa.
The salsa is different to that one because that one's cooked.
That's a chutney.
Chutney salsa. Salsa raw.
Are they cousins? Oh, yeah, they are.
Yeah, cousins.
Because they have a mix.
That one is onion.
All right, so I'm tired of watching Brian stirring and Khanyi just burning.
I'm not burning,
can
I'm
we
creating.
Make something now?
I'm creating.
Okay, so let's assemble our tacos. So you're going to take your taco and be creating layers. We're going to start with the lentil chutney, just a little bit.
Okay.
And then we need some guac. Z, I need you to come
and everyone gets to make their own taco, right? It's just more fun that way.
Okay, cool. But then I'm going to grab one as well.
Remember we said we're all the kids coming from that special needs bus.
That includes him.
No, Brian, you have to do it for Brian.
He used to sit with the driver.
Yeah.
And then, Brian, you finish it off with some salsa.
And that's it.
Mm-hmm. And then we put it on the plate and we make it look pretty.
I'm gonna try the guac.
Well, what about the chutney? Or is the chutney in the...
It's the foundation.
Right, the chutney is in the lentil situation.
Yes, because it's a tomato and basil lentil chutney.
Beautiful, beautiful. Wow, Brian, that actually looks delicious. It actually looks like there's meat in there too.
Yes, you see. And then because of the flavor, I'm telling you, blindfold yourself, you will believe that this is meat.
All right, that is fantastic.
Oh, then.
And it's just that simple, guys. So
Brian, will you believe this
remember, you can do this for yourself. The recipe, complex as it is on our Facebook page, The Weekend on 3. Otherwise, the conversation all throughout social media is hashtag The Weekend edition. We'll be right back after this.
It's a weekend, yeah. Yeah.
Welcome back to the Weekend Edition. We've got my man Brian Temba. Yes. I keep wanting to say Temba, but Temba.
You did?
We did something special for us actually earlier today. You drew your life.
Yeah.
And we'd like to show the people what you drew.
Okay.
Can we get into it?
Yeah.
Let's... All right, so here's Brian Temba right now drawing his life.
Welcome to Draw My Life with me, Brian Temba. I'm gonna take you through my journey. I started singing at church in 1995. For the first time, I was very nervous, but I managed to pull it off. In 1998, I decided I wanted to sing professionally, and I went to the big gold city, which is Johannesburg, and I had a shot. Vicky Villegas gave me a shot in Joy Celebration. After that, gave me a shot, and I started singing with them in 1998 up until 2000. Then I auditioned for The Lion King, and for the very first time, I got on the plane. And I was part of Walt Disney's The Lion King as part of the ensemble. And I auditioned then in 2003 to be part of The Lion King UK, and I was the first South African Simba ever in the world, and that was a joy. Now, while I was in the UK, I had a chance to record my very first album called Something Better, and that album actually won Summer Best R&B in 2010. And now we're in 2016. I got to be part of one of the most popular soul pieces, Muvhango on SABC 2, as Run To Man, one of the leads. And now I'm a star. This is my life in drawing.
All right, so that was your life. In a nutshell.
Don't laugh, man.
Don't laugh. Listen, you've traveled a lot. You've been to many different places. How many countries would you say music has taken you to?
Gosh, some countries are not from music. Like, you know, when I was in London, I could travel. London,
I could just get on the train or go anywhere,
you know. So I went to Italy, I went to Turkey, I went to Egypt.
Wow.
But the Brits love to go to Egypt. My son's mother, they also did the trip to Egypt, the Hyderabad. What is it called? There's a coastal city resort there that most of us never really get to hear about.
Exactly.
So you went to Egypt, man. And what was that experience like?
Amazing.
Yeah?
I went to the pyramids and everything
else. Of course you
did. And Sphinx and everything else.
And you saw it with your own eyes?
Yes.
You ride a camel?
Definitely. I did for the first time.
Yeah.
They spit.
I don't know, but they never spit on me, so I'm happy about that.
All right, let's talk about some music, man, and music that you like. Firstly, you released a single, My Number One, featuring Uhuru. What inspired that, and how'd you guys work together?
You know, I'm a producer, by the way. I don't know if a lot of people know about that. I was sitting, actually, a year ago, I was exposed to Kizomba.
You know, the dance.
Kizomba and the music, and you know, the Kizomba music, it's Angolan, it's popular in Angola and Mozambique as well. And a lot of people, you know, sampled that kind of style.
Like, is it that Justin slow music Bieber, where it's like,
but it's
a swing, but
It's vibey. West Indians actually do that music a lot. And I was exposed to it, particularly Angolan music. And I was like, I love this. I want to do this kind of music at some point in my life. And when I was working on my album, I thought, I'm gonna do it. And I started it, I just did it. But what's nice about this song is that it has mbaqanga guitars. Mm. So it sets it apart from the actual Kizomba song. So I did that and I was in awe. I was like, okay, I can do this. I'm a producer, wow.
Yeah.
Great. And I called my boys, I had spoken to them a long time ago, Uhuru.
Yeah.
And I said, yo, can we get into the studio? Obviously, you can't find them. Like,
they're busy.
Man, so it took me forever to find them.
Yeah.
But eventually I locked them down and they loved the song.
Yeah, who from important. Uhuru did you manage to get in the studio?
Kelly.
Okay.
Kelly Mpilo is he's the lead vocalist. Mm. And I got him into the studio. I was with them, actually. And I got him into the studio and my number one came out.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's dope. You're currently working on your third album, right?
Yes.
How do you pronounce this? Un-ABC or?
Un-ABC.
What does that mean?
Unapologetic, unbreakable, uncensored.
Is this like an adult album? Is this it's not no, for the kids? No. Like what, you know what I mean?
No, you know what? I'm unapologetic because I've always done R&B music and yeah. I've never been apologetic about that.
Have you gotten flack for doing R&B? In this market in particular?
Well, you know, I've had some of the grown-up artists say, yeah, yenza mkula sekhaya, man, you know? Mm. Do something Afropop or something, you know?
Yeah.
And I was like, nah, I just want... I remember the very first album never had a Zulu song or, you know, and I understood that part of it. Mm. You can do R&B music and you can put, you know, you can do it in Vinac.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But I never understood because I was hardcore R&B, American R&B,
yeah.
and I didn't want to change that.
Yeah.
But the minute I did, the song Zanele, South Africa went crazy for it. And for me, it was like, wow, okay, so I can do this. So on the third album, I actually have a few Zulu songs, which are amazing. Obviously, it's my style, but it's songs that I love.
Yeah.
I never knew I could love singing Zulu songs like that.
Right, right, right.
Yeah.
Is R&B kind of over? You know how like rock had a moment and then
yeah,
it didn't?
Yeah.
I feel like R&B, 80s, 90s, it was like, and then now it's not, even what they call R&B today is not.
No. What they call R&B is not R&B at all. Because it's
usually. Like you wouldn't say Rihanna's R&B,
no,
right?
No.
I'd say, who does R&B
Beyonce?
These days? No.
No.
She's pop. Yeah, they're all pop.
CeeLo?
CeeLo Green is R&B.
CeeLo Green is R&B.
Yeah. Right? Is Usher doing R&B?
Yeah, somewhat pop R&B. Pop R&B, pop R&B.
Yeah. Right.
But if you're saying R&B, you're talking about rhythm and blues. I think I do pop R&B, actually.
Okay.
Because there are some you know, British-influenced songs, like guitars, a lot more guitars, and, you know. But I am an R&B artist. I've always loved your Marvin Gaye's. Yeah. Those are the people that I call proper rhythm and
Mary
blues artists.
Right.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah.
And of course, in the whole soul movement, there was a British UK soul movement as well that came and went, it seems, as well.
Huh? Definitely, yeah. Lamar's, Omar, yeah. It did come and go, but it's difficult.
During your time in the UK, did you ever get a chance to collab or work with some of these artists? Your Jazzy B's, your Omar's, your...
I've met
Craig
them.
Craig David's.
Who's the other one who passed away? Sexy Cinderella.
Yes.
Yes.
What's his name? Lindenhall.
Lyndon, yeah, R.I.P. to him. Yeah,
definitely. Those were R&B artists.
Yeah.
I got to work with people that worked with them, like the producers. You know, the producer that produced my very first album actually worked with all of them.
Wow.
Oh,
you know?
Okay.
Yeah, so and he was my mentor as well in terms of production and everything else. So,
yeah,
so I never got to work with them. I would have loved to, but I worked with producers that worked with them.
You having lived in the UK, a lot of people think, like, to make it really big, you have to go to the West. How would you describe the music industry in the UK as compared to South Africa? Are there parallels? Because the UK are also caught up in the whole trying to make it big in America. That seems to be, like, the benchmark of...
Yeah.
You know, maybe it's because it's a small population, small island, similar size populations.
Yeah.
We have 50 million, they're about 60 million people.
Yeah, yeah. You know, in the UK, if you're trying to do soul music, you have a niche market. You have your market in Birmingham, around the UK.
You got to do pop in the UK.
You have to do pop.
Yeah, if Capital's not playing you,
you have to.
And
unfortunately, you know, the example is, you know, Jesse J.
Jesse J.
You don't know Jesse J.
Jesse J.
Jesse J is a popular UK artist.
Right.
Now she's big in the US as well.
Oh, Jesse J. I know Jesse J.
Yes.
Yes.
Jesse J is huge, you
yes.
know? We were in the same circles of, we used to do like open
got a
mics.
Big voice, actually.
And,
yeah.
Yeah, we used to do open mics and all of that.
Is she like this lady who died?
Amy Winehouse.
Yeah.
No. She's younger,
vocalist.
She sings.
All right, okay.
Jesse J is good.
Amazing singer. We were in the same circles in the UK.
Yeah.
You know, open mics, if you go to an open mic, you'll find all of us there.
Yeah.
She's big now.
She's huge now, you know. But I can say that there are a whole lot more better singers than her that we were in the, you know, some of the people that we were in the circle with.
That's crazy.
Yeah. So sometimes, sometimes.
It's a mix of things. You don't have to be the best singer, but
exactly.
You do have to have.
Season.
Yeah.
It's your season.
There's other battles that you fight, you know, especially when you're in England.
Yeah.
There's other battles that, you know, I don't really want to speak about.
Yeah.
But you fight, if you're, literally a black boy or a black person in the UK. Mm. It's hard to make it.
There's this Indian cat who sings R&B as well. He signed to Cash Money. I don't know what's wrong with me. I keep forgetting people's names today.
I know who he's talking about.
But I would assume he was also around the same circles because I got to hear of him around the same time. The name will come to me, man. Ugh.
Exactly,
but he's also become an international pop star, mega hits and stuff like that. And he signed to Cash Money with Lil Wayne and those guys. Yeah. And I would imagine also not necessarily the best talent, but
just money as well.
Other things, money.
If you got money, hey, you know, you're good.
There you go. There you go. All right, man. Just one more question about music.
Yes.
You were featured on the soundtrack for Pride, starring Terrence Howard, right? Pride was the movie about the swimming, the swimming team in Philadelphia, right?
Yeah.
It was Terrence Howard and the comedian.
Bernie Mac.
Bernie Mac, who also passed away. How did you get on that soundtrack?
Level M, man.
Oh, he's the hookup.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Level M used to do a lot of these movies, you know?
Yes.
He used to do scoring or... He would write some South African.
He even did Tarzan now. All the scoring for Tarzan
Listen
was
Liam.
Yeah.
So he used because we were in London. You know, he used to call us up. You know, even with Tears of the Sun, it was the same thing. Because he would get these movies, and obviously they would want a South African sound and whatnot. So he would because we were closer. We were in The Lion King, so he would just call us in, and that's how we got on.
Is that how you got on The Lion King? He brought you in.
He auditioned me.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, no, he couldn't just bring me.
Yeah. No, that's what I mean.
He auditioned me.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right, no, that's fantastic. All right, well, we're going to go to one more performance with you. We've got Brian Temba here. He's our musical guest for today. He's still going to stick around, but right now, here's a performance just for you.
This song was written in London by a friend of mine, and it's a conversation with God, actually. And the song is called Dominoes.
Said I never needed love, something I was certain of. Didn't need it getting in the way. My defenses over time, built around this heart of mine. I was sure my thoughts would never change. Then you came slowly undermine what I thought I knew. Unguarded, I gave up the fight. So you win my regards. They fell down just like dominoes. They fell. Disappointed by a few, hopeful for a while but then deferred. Wondered after my mistakes, would my heart ever unbreak? Any chance that love could never burn? Oh. They fell down just
right, guys, we're gonna take a short break. Weekend edition, we'll be right back. It's a weekend, yeah. It's a weekend, yeah. All right, guys, welcome back to the weekend edition. The entire squad is here. Zikhona decided to invite a special guest.
Yes.
Huh?
Put us all under pressure.
Put us all under pressure. It's not her boyfriend.
No,
pressure.
No, no,
it's not her man.
It's not her designer either.
Not her side piece.
No, it's not even her handbag.
John Morrison, welcome to the Weekend Edition.
Nice to be here.
You are a dance instructor.
Yeah, that's right.
You are her dance instructor.
One of them, probably.
One of them. Yes.
Oh, really?
See, busy girl.
Just real quick, how long have you been dancing for?
I've been dancing, you know, like, socially for 9-10 years.
She had to qualify that. Socially.
Yes. Socially.
Yeah, no, no, no. I'm not a private dancer.
She was like,
no,
I'm a enthusiast. I'm not a salsa dancer.
I'm not a salsa dancer. He's a salsa dancer. So I'm excited and enthusiastic about the dance.
The first time you went dancing, 10 years, long time, did someone take you? Did you take yourself?
Someone took me. So I was down in Cape Town filming something. One of the crew members found out that I like things off the booty. Yeah. So she takes me to a place called Mona.
That serves things off the booty.
Yes, like a dance.
Yes.
What do you mean things off the booty?
Like a dance, the booty.
Yes. Oh, not the booty, the booty.
The booty.
I heard booty, right? Brian, you heard booty too, right?
That
I heard
too.
Booty.
That too. You can't ignore it, it is there. So then she took me to Buena Vista, and the rest is history, literally 10 years ago.
Wow. When so you're Buena a professional, Vista used basically.
To be here. So shy.
Well, every time she comes down to Cape Town.
So you run the Que Pasa Dance Studio. Tell us a bit about that.
It runs out of the Artscape. It runs 7 days a week, and it's been going for the last 15 years.
Yeah. Wow. Is there a capacity, or is it like come one, come all?
It doesn't make a difference. Anybody, everybody.
Really?
Yeah, anything from 16 to 80.
Right.
And you name it.
And what type of people generally come for dance? Is it dance lessons, or is it more like a communal fraternity club thing?
It's open to anybody, so anybody can come. So it's not a club so much.
Yeah.
It's a dance class, and during the week we run dance classes, and on the weekends we do parties.
So, like, if you're a first-timer or a no-timer like me and Brian, how do you get the balls to go to a club where people are showing off and showing out and screaming and cheering?
First, you come to a dance class.
Oh, you have to come to the class.
Well, you know, you don't have to. You can just show up and you can shake it up.
What's your recommendation? How many classes before you step out into a salsa party?
That depends how confident you are.
Isn't that the confidence thing? Yeah.
Yeah, it's a big, big thing. Confidence is everything.
Right, right, right.
So if you've got the confidence to just get out there, you can go to a party and shake it up.
Okay.
And copy someone.
All right, 10 years in the game. I want to see, can you show us how dope she is right now? I want to see what 10 years will get me.
Be kind. Yes, be gentle.
There's a lot happening here. Let's do this.
What are you laughing?
One day, Joe.
Oh.
Okay, follow me, right?
Yes.
I'm gonna try. Side
to side. Okay. See, I didn't know that.
You're good, you're good.
This is true. Wow.
Yeah.
It's all about the booty.
Let's talk!
John, why does she look like she has more rhythm than you? Wow.
One day.
Easy.
It's not easy. I'm holding my breath. It's hard. Oh my gosh.
Beautiful. Beautiful. So how do you do that for like an hour nonstop?
It's
3 hours.
Proper cardio.
Yeah.
You relax, you have a dance, you relax, you have a dance, you watch people, you have a dance, you relax, you have a drink, you watch people. It's not just 3 hours of this.
Of just boom, boom, boom.
Yeah, yeah.
Here's the crazy thing. I find in Cape Town, you don't have to go to a salsa dance event to see people salsering.
No.
At all the clubs, people do it here,
really?
Especially Cape Tonians.
Oh, really?
It's a thing.
Yeah. It's a thing.
Well, they call it jazzing, but it's actually salsa,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. It's a form of jazz, yeah.
No? Oh, it's a form.
Yeah, it's a form.
It's like
it's
a
similar.
No.
It's
yeah, yeah, similar.
Yeah,
right. All right, and tell us a little bit more about, are there health benefits to doing this?
Absolutely.
Is this something?
It keeps you fit. Yeah. Keeps you fit. Keeps you energized. It makes, if you've had a long day, you go for some dancing and it just revitalizes you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Makes you happy.
But yeah. I would like Khanyi to sweat a bit, won't you just?
Oh.
No?
Well, after that, I'm a bit shy, but
no,
I can try.
What are you talking about?
All right, let's try.
No. Yes.
You've never done it. Have you ever done it before?
I've done it on Strictly Come Dancing,
oh,
but
yeah.
I...
Get up, girl, get up.
No, nah, not yeah, this yeah, type. Yeah,
get up.
No. Okay. I did the... Yes. Okay.
You know?
Okay. I'm going to try being you.
No, do the hair, girl, because I don't have the hair. Do that.
See, Brian, they like to pretend like they're beginners, but they all have hectic, deep experience.
Okay, you ready?
Yes.
That women like a man that can dance.
Oh, right, right. That is true.
Huh? Ooh.
Yes!
Did
I say yes?
Yes! This is hard, though.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh. I can't.
Yes,
the hair.
Yes,
Zama, do you want to try this?
I want to try.
Huh? I think you should. Come try. Come try. Come try. Come try.
Yes, come try. Come try. Yes.
Yes.
Come try.
Yes.
And she's got a smile on her.
Okay.
So back and forward. There we go.
Oh.
Back.
Oh. First timer. There we go.
Yes. Yes. There we go. Spin. I'm ready to
come
spin.
In. Okay.
She
come
wants
on.
To spin. Little spin.
Yes.
Hey. Oh, you're awesome!
Wow, man.
I think it's a good lesson.
Your chance, Joe.
No. I'm like Brian, man, you know.
No, but you know what I think it is? It's a good lesson for independent women because we forget to let men lead sometimes.
Absolutely, that's what I was
I
about
think
to
it's
say.
Got a lesson for yeah. women today.
At the same time, it allows women to be successful.
To be.
Yeah.
Right.
Did you see how she stepped out? Did you see how she was
And she was like,
out?
Where's
she's
the
like,
spin?
Yeah, straight up, chest out, tush back.
Tush back, yes. Hands.
That's all you need. But yeah, it's this much work, especially yeah. You don't dance with a blazer on in real life.
Yeah, no, they wear skimpy outfits, yeah. Which are really nice, and I understand yeah. why, because it gets really, really yeah. warm.
Yeah.
I've wow. got two left feet. This was my father's thing.
No,
he was like a ballroom champ. He was like the...
There's no
such
thing.
There's no such thing.
You're my best
man. It's like me and football.
But Joe, are you like really good at saying no to a girl? Because if I'd show you a 1 and a 5, would you say no?
You would you say no to a girl,
Joe? She
says, am I good at saying no to women? I'm good at saying, let's go to commercial break. Wow, man. Well, John, thank you for coming to hang out with
thank
us.
You.
Really appreciate that and showing us how easy it is. Me and Brian are going to go for a little private lesson just
yeah.
now, right?
And,
but
and
you
maybe,
know
and
what
maybe
we need it here in studio? We need a Josie, because Josie's always doing interesting things.
Yeah, Josie's yeah. out in Stellenbosch right now. She actually gets to make her own blend of coffee. And then she goes out and checks out a bit of nature and how nature has the ability to sort of look after itself. She's always doing cool stuff, so
always.
Take a look at this.
Welcome to another weekend adventure of Where Josie Goes. Together with you, I'm going to be exploring South Africa and all its hidden gems and ticking off that rather long bucket list. We're in the beautiful town of Stellenbosch. Summer is in full swing. And although when you think Stellenbosch, you think wine, there's also some coffee on offer. So I'm about to get my Saturday morning fix.
Vergenoegd Wine Estate offers truly remarkable experiences to visitors in search of something original. They've chosen evocative food ingredients, wine, olive oil, tea, and coffee, for personalized blending experiences that are educational, sensory, and unhurried.
Morning, Ryan.
Hey, Josie, welcome.
Thanks, lovely to meet you. I believe you've got me covered for a different coffee blending experience this morning.
Sure, so I think the reason that you've never done it before is there's not a lot of places that do it. And that's one of the reasons that we do it is because you can't really find it anywhere else. One of our main processes is just to ask people what they think. And the big comment we had was, well, we don't want to always drink wine on a wine farm. Can we do other stuff? So that's where the olive oil came in and then the tea and coffee came in.
During the blending, you learn the history and provenance of the different single-origin coffees and explore the various ways the flavor and aroma can be complementary. There's lovely technical knowledge that is shared, but the real focus is on the individual sensory response. At the end of the experience, each person's unique blend is packaged and personalized for them to take home, and it can be reordered in the future as every custom blend is stored in the library.
coffee and chocolate. Ideal start to the weekend. So yeah. Happy go.
Start with coffee and chocolate and end with wine and cheese, right? Cheese
and wine. Life is tough.
Yeah. It's so difficult.
It's not just the blending experiences that set this estate apart from the rest. It also hosts regular events, including a weekly Saturday morning family run or walk along its popular weekend market. A new development is that the farm is hosting summer picnic concerts featuring top local artists and bands on the first Sunday of every month. The real standout, though, is the farm's focus on biodiversity, including a water bird habitat and water conservation project. This initiative is rehabilitating bodies of water to become attractive habitats for indigenous water birds.
This is Saturday entertainment like never before. The crowds are around us. The ducks are the real workers at Phat Joe Farm. They've been here since 1984, and there are 1,000 ducks. This is so awesome.
The 1,000 Indian summer ducks are essential to the farm's pest control, consuming a large amount of snails and bugs on their daily patrols, and they are also a big part of why the farm carries a WWF biodiversity certification. The duck parade has become a daily ritual where the flock is proudly showed off before they head on to the vineyards.
Well, from the ultimate early morning blending coffee experience here to some great live local music, a waddling workforce, which is the ducks doing all the work, and just a really great place to come as a family and chill out for a weekend, this is the Stellenbosch I love. But from an early morning coffee buzz, I think I'm ready for the next afternoon buzz, and this one involves some wine.
At Jordan Wine Estate, a tasting experience can take on a whole new twist with a safari-style tour of the vineyards. There are breathtaking views of the winelands, False Bay and Table Bay, and there's plenty to learn about the geology, terroir and their sustainable farming practices while tasting their outstanding wines.
So Ibn, why the idea of putting wine and safari together in one?
I think this is just the perfect location. So you're actually coming in between the vineyards, you can actually taste what the grapes taste like and then drink the wine, so the end product.
Other than that, there's a really cool factor about chameleons and some sort of project around that and sustainability. Tell us a little bit more about that.
Well, the Jordans are very generous. First of all, they've created this chameleon range. So for every bottle of wine which gets sold under the chameleon brand, it goes for a certain donation. So for people studying in the line of chameleons, they give money towards that as well.
Okay, and then other than your award-winning wines and this view, there's a few different things that you offer here at the farm. Tell us more about that.
Well, we also have accommodation, which is quite new on the estate. So now you've got something to drink, you've got something to eat, and you can also sleep over.
Perfect, the three ticks.
The three ticks, yes.
Love it. Now, Ibn, I think this is definitely unbeatable in my books, but you've said there's a second stop that's a different view?
Well, the next stop will be right at the back, so you can see a whole Cape Town area. So you'll see Table Mountain, Lion's Head, and also Signal Hill.
The vineyards here lie at various altitudes from 160 to 410 meters above sea level and enjoy a mild Mediterranean climate with influence from both the Indian and Atlantic oceans.
This is incredible.
No, this is a spectacular place to be. So just to be here, I normally tell the guests, just keep quiet for about 10 seconds, listen to the nature, experience the sunset with a glass of wine. I can't think about anything else in the world.
Anything that's better.
Where you can, yeah, match this.
In the terms of that, you said that all of the surrounding vineyards on this side of the slope are obviously red varietals and they need more sun. Tell us about that.
Yes, basically this is your west-facing slope. So if you look in front of you, that's Cape Town.
Okay.
And you get a nice Atlantic breeze over the vineyards. So the reason for Gary planting all the red grapes at the back is because red grapes needs more sunlight to ripen. And this is the ideal place at the back.
Incredible. Well, thinking about safari and when you go to the bush and you hear all the sounds, we have that now, as you can hear.
Yes, no, definitely.
And it's so amazing to experience the terroir of the wine and enjoy it even more. You guys actually have this as an option for a sunset drive. And as you said, this is magic. I don't think it gets better in Stellenbosch than this.
I don't think so, yeah. This is the highlight.
Awesome.
Yes.
Step, step, together. So back, back, step, together, and forward, step, together. One, two, three. 5, 6, 7. And 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 7. Good. 1, 2, 3, ladies. Throw it in. And 1, 2, 3.
Ooh.
5, 6, 7. And 1, 2. Look at you, Joe.
All right.
Point of mistake.
While we learn the basics,
1, 2, 3.
We're going to take a short break.
5, 6, 7.
And we'll be right back.
You're going to turn.
Hashtag the weekend edition.
All right, guys, welcome back. We're in the kitchen. We're cooking. Is it still a mystery? Is it, or have we gotten past the mystery?
We passed that now.
Oh, okay,
we
so legumes, it. Beans.
Health and goodness.
Health and goodness. What are we making now? Is this, would this be a dessert?
Yes. It's a dessert.
Hey,
it's a savory
veg.
Dessert. Listen, dessert.
This is how you trick your children.
With veg.
Beetroot dessert.
Yeah, okay. All right, this is how you trick the kids. Actually. So we're going to make an orange beet pop, and we're going to make a lime mint pop. Peep pop.
Okay. An orange
yes.
What?
Beet an pop. Orange oh. Beet pop. So basically with this one I love because you literally just chuck all your ingredients together.
Yeah,
you
would have
yes, please. You would have cooked your beetroot already.
I'll hold it.
And then you add tahini.
What is tahini?
Tahini is lovely goodness made out of chickpeas and other savory spices.
So what is it like? It's like juiced chickpeas with some spices in it.
Yes.
Okay.
It goes well, especially if you make hummus, you'll use tahini.
Okay.
Okay.
I thought hummus was just squashed and mashed chickpeas.
Mm. With tahini. And then get some orange flesh into the mix.
All right.
And then we will blend it all together. Oh, wait, some garlic.
Are you serious?
Garlic. Yes. Some olive oil.
Savory.
Are we done with this?
Yes, dessert. We're done and then with when that. Does this go in?
And then this is orange juice.
Dessert.
And the olive oil?
Right at the end.
This is dessert, yeah.
It's dessert.
It's dessert.
Guys, don't shoot it till you try it.
Did you say it's like a kiddie's dessert?
This is how you trick your children. The color's gonna be beautiful. And it's gonna look amazing. It's gonna look like one of their favorite things. So basically, you blend it all together.
My daughter must see you mix that because then she'll be like,
in the middle of the night.
Yes.
And then add some olive oil. This is gonna give your smoothness.
Right.
And then blend some more.
All right, we won't do that because we'll make a big mess and we'll all be very pink.
And then you'll have this.
Wow, looks good.
Orange
and
peep pop.
Mm-hmm. What does it taste
and then
like?
Do, so this
beetroot
would be the dessert
orange.
That you would...
Beetroot that you would.
Yes. All right. And then, so we're going to shoot, we're going to make both of them at the same time because it's popsicles, we need them to freeze at the same time.
Oh,
okay.
Wow. Oh, snap.
Oh, that's why you call them beet pops. I was wondering, beet pops. Okay.
Yes.
All right.
And then in here, we have garlic, onion, split peas. And then this would have cooked off for about 30 to 45 minutes. And then you puree it as well.
Thank you.
Guys, why don't you wait for the finished product?
Oh, I just want to... I'm curious. Okay.
I'm curious what that tastes like.
What does it taste like?
But beetroot and orange juice, like when you blend and make a juice out of beetroot and orange, it usually tastes nice.
Okay.
When is the juice?
So then you'd blend this.
Okay.
You see?
All right.
Yes, in the middle of the night, and then you'd add your pea puree. Sorry, your mint puree.
Okay, I was about
that's,
to say.
That's where the freshness is gonna come from. Some hot sauce.
Yes. All that sauce. All that sauce.
Are you serious? This is just pure hot sauce.
Yes.
Ooh.
And
all
then lime.
That's legit.
Lime mint pea pop.
Ooh.
Mix it all together.
It's real.
Blend it some more. And then you have something that looks like this.
Oh, and that's what we trick the kids with.
This is what you trick the kids with.
With the hot sauce.
Okay.
With the
hot and then
I can just see my little 3-year-old.
Yeah.
Like, and then there's nothing. Like, what do you.
But they have these amazing things at store. It's like an ice cube holder, but this, a popsicle one, has the sticks to go with it.
Yes.
And then you put in the freezer. Orange beet pop.
But
Summer,
that's
taste
not
that.
Good, sorry.
I just saw that.
It's frozen.
I see this, but this. Look, I see the beet pop one, but the green one.
The green one is for adults. There's no the children will enjoy the pink one.
You can even drizzle some honey on it, and then they'll go crazy because then you got some sweetness going.
Has this been tried and tested in a real marketplace?
In a real marketplace with children? I don't have children, but I imagine.
That's what I'm thinking. You don't have kids, yeah.
But I ever did, this is what I have for my children.
We have kids. We like kids. I'm
trying to give them a long life. But either way, this is also great for the festive season when you have adults coming over. It's something playful to give them that's out of the norm. Put this on a platter, go around. If they're having cocktails, just...
But I noticed that's the trend as well with these gourmet ice creams is to have these weird flavored ice creams, you know?
Yes,
pumpkin
yes.
flavored,
I don't know about
flavored.
Those yeah. trends, but yeah. this is what I'm cooking up in my kitchen.
All right, huh? Yes. Well, there we go, man.
Well, I'd like to try that and, yes. and sample.
Try yes.
All right, yeah.
I'll try the real
While
one.
We hand those out, guys, don't forget, recipes are on social media. Hashtag the weekend edition. We will
girl.
Be right
Let's
back.
Brian, oh. I believe in you. Even grown men can have popsicles.
It's so nice.
Nabi.
What happened?
Nah.
All right, guys, welcome back to the weekend edition. Let's eat.
Yeah, let's eat, but before we do, if you're wondering how we made all of these meals, it's so simple. You need to go to our Facebook page, which is The Weekend Edition, and you can find it. But here's a recap if you've missed any of us making this. Here is Zama giving us the recap of our recipes.
Our theme in the kitchen today is inspired by the year of the pulses. For the salad, cook the quinoa as per package instructions. Mix together olive oil, balsamic vinegar, garlic, basil, and thyme. Add the quinoa, rocket, chickpeas, black beans, red lentils, bell peppers, and olives in a large serving bowl. Drizzle with the dressing and garnish with extra basil. For the chutney, place lentils in a pot with vegetable stock. Cook until soft, cut the tomatoes and roughly chop the basil. Heat sesame oil in a pan and cook tomatoes with the basil, chilies, and Worcester sauce. Toast spices and add them to the tomatoes. Take the mixture off the heat and blend. Stir in the cooked lentils. Serve with guacamole and fresh salsa. For the orange beet pop, boil beetroot until tender. Place the chickpeas, beetroot, spices, tahini, lemon juice, and garlic in a food processor. Add orange juice and olive oil and process until smooth. Place into a popsicle container and freeze overnight before enjoying. For the lime mint pop, cook onion and herbs until soft. Add peas and lemon zest, salt and lemon juice. Mix into the mint puree with some hot sauce to taste. Freeze before serving. For the full recipes, visit the Weekend Edition Facebook page.
All right, so I'm stuck with the lollipop or the popsicle, right?
Yes.
You tasted it. How does it taste?
It tastes good. It's healthy.
It's delicious.
It's delicious. It's good. It's different.
All right, well, I dare to taste this, Brian. I know you're eating right now, but you gotta go perform.
Pay for your food.
It's time for your final performance. Brian Temba here. We're almost done, but enjoy.
My number one is a song that I actually worked with Uhuru on. This was an experiment. As an experiment, as a producer, I wanted to do something different. I did, and it came out like this. Yeah.
Thank you, Brian Temba. On that note, guys, thank you for joining us. We've come to the end of the show. Zama, thank you for the beautiful food.
Delicious.
The bean-themed vegetarian. Oh, you're killing
pulse,
the
pulse.
Beautiful.
Pulse.
Right, is it beautiful? You made half of that, right?
I did.
Yeah? Mm. And Zikhona, thank you for bringing John Morrison today, your Latin dance instructor, and giving us some... why are you laughing?
I'm smiling.
Oh, you're smiling. And thank you for joining us. Really appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
Hopefully you've had a good time. And you guys, we'll catch you guys next weekend on the Weekend Edition. We're out of here.
Bye.